Thanks. I'm Alan Parkinson. I'm actually a freelance software engineer, so I get to work with lots of different companies over the course of a year. And I'm going to be telling you sort of my journey for the last year dealing with security. I should start off with a disclaimer. I'm not a security expert. I'm a developer passionate about quality. And security is part of quality. The reason I've been involved in security in the last year is I started a greenfield e-commerce project start of last year. And this presents lots of issues. E-commerce was new to me, and we had major compliance issues to sort out. We've got the PCI standard. So this, as we're handling credit card data, we have a set of rules to comply to. So this means security audits, scanning of our application. And this happens on different frequency. So we'd get audited, say, every quarter or every month by an external third party. But we might be releasing up to 100 times with it in between audits. And if the audit is a three-month window, that's 90 days where a security vulnerability could be out there, somebody could be exploiting. We also have privacy laws, protect people's data. If I was using a system, I'd want to know that my email address was safe. So this leads to also ethics. As a professional, I want to do the best job possible. Would I use this system? And when I speak to people about security, some people's attitude, this can be a little disappointing. They'll say their site's too small to actually worth testing for security. Nobody wants to break into it. Last year, about time I was kicking off this project, a friend of mine had a bricks and mortar business, but they also had a small e-commerce system on the side. They only turned over a few hundred pounds a month, but their system actually got compromised. It got so thoroughly compromised, they couldn't actually work out when this happened, what data was lost. They actually had to stop their e-commerce side for 2 months and actually get a whole new system in. So this was a lesson to me, and I really wanted to make sure I didn't repeat the same mistakes. The other thing is, I looked at hiring a security professional to work with us on this project. They are expensive. The daily rate is three times that of a contract software developer. So I was going to be wasting a lot of my testing and development budget by actually having somebody on full-time, even a lot of budget if they were in part-time and come in once a month. So I wanted to find out a way of actually reducing the amount of time I needed to hire a security professional for. So I looked around at security tools. What can I use as a developer or a tester that allow me to pick up the common issues early before we hit a release, or early before the security professional gets on it? Also, it allows them to focus on the more important issues that their manual tester skills actually can focus on. So there's a particular type of tool called attack proxies. They sit between your tester and your application under test and actually look at the traffic and look at the interactions between the tester and your application. But also they allow the tester to manipulate that traffic. So once you've sent an HTTP request to your application, they can actually go in and modify some of the values to actually simulate an attack. So this is quite good, but it still requires a lot of manual use. You also got third-party scanning companies. So you can pay somebody to scan your site on a regular basis for security vulnerabilities. Particular problem with this is they cannot actually attack your site because they are scanning your production system. They cannot do a proper full-blown attack because they could potentially take your site down or actually compromise it and leave it compromised. So this is a bit of a problem. And these third-party services are what are used by the bank for PCI compliance to make sure you're complying. So not the perfect answer. So relying on this was also not an option because I wanted to do the best job possible. So I came across a tool called the Zed Attack Proxy, also known as ZAP. It's an open source project. It was originally a fork from a well-known attack proxy called Paris Proxy, which is no longer being developed. It was first released in 2010 and quickly became an OWASP top-level project. OWASP is a foundation that promotes security awareness in amongst developers and testers. So they provide guides like the OWASP Top 10, which lists the top 10 most common and important security issues to be aware of. Also, they'll suggest strategies to avoid these and help open source projects to around in the security area. Okay, one reason I chose Zap was because it was designed for novices to use. It can be used by professional penetration testers, but there's lots of documentation about each vulnerability with the application. So when I was looking into something, I could look up references, further information, actually as a novice security person, actually makes sense of it. So it actually has a number of different features. So it can passively scan HTTP traffic, so look for grep for say common patterns and known security issues. So that could be the HTTP flags around cookies are not correctly set. So if you have some compromised JavaScript running on your site, potentially a hacker could steal your cookie, and if you've got sensitive information in your cookie, they're going to have possession of that. You've got active scanners, so they can do cross-site scripting and CQL injection attacks on your application. But also, they've got spiders for actually searching through your application to make sure you've got as much traffic as possible to analyze. But also, you've got fuzzing, which is where you generate random data and put it into the parameters of your different post requests to see if you can actually make the program crash, cause any memory leaks, anything you could exploit as a attacker. There's also quite a few more tools in Zap, and it's extendable. It has a plugin architecture, so people can come along and write new attack methods for it. So to get started with Zap, Zap runs as an HTTP proxy. So you just need to insert it between the tester and your application under test. By default, I think it runs on port 8090. I'm going to be showing a demo shortly, and I've got it running on port 8080. So at the moment, we still require the manual tester to actually explore our application and actually generate a lot of HTTP traffic. Having a good suite of automated browser tests, I thought, well, why don't I leverage the value of these tests and actually run them instead of a manual tester? So I actually managed to replace the manual tester with my tests and run the test through the proxy. So running the test through the manual proxy is great for doing this sort of passive scanning, finding the common sort of errors you can detect sort of by pattern matching. But you've got the active attacks. You can actually actively scan once your application, once Zap knows the control surfaces of your applications, all the different URLs. It can actually go on and try and attack them all. So this active features should only be used on your test system, not your production site, not somebody else's site. Use it on somebody else's site, you're likely to get the police knocking on your door for a polite conversation. The other thing is you can also spider your site. So if you don't, some people, their first attempt at automated security testing is not to use, say, browser tests. They'll run a spider. The spider has a few issues. The spider just understands HTTP and can find links. In today's modern websites, we've got an awful lot of JavaScript that pulling for different services, pulling data from all over the place. So actually using browser tests to stimulate a Zap allows us to uncover a lot of the REST services. So I always do recommend using the browser and using the spider only when you actually don't have tests you could use. So how do we go around converting WebDriver tests to work with Zap? So first thing we need to do is actually make them use the HTTP proxy so it can actually analyze the traffic. The second thing is if you've got lots of different security levels within your application, you actually have to run your tests within groups. So if you have lots of access by user accounts that sign up, you would need to run all these tests together. Because if you're doing an active attack, you don't want to mix URLs for admin functions with sort of access that anybody can have to your site. The main reason is Zap is not intelligent. It can't work out whether it should be able to access this address or not access this address with different security roles. But also it's intelligent that it can store from the traffic, it can actually store session IDs. So it can reuse user sessions for when it's performing an attack. So nice simple code to actually, you just need to add to your test to set up a proxy. So we're going to use create a proxy object. By the way, this is the web driver only. I haven't actually tested it on any of my older tests. So we create a proxy object and set our proxy details. So auto detect false. We're doing a manual configuration. And then we're running ZAP on the local host on port 8080. Next thing we need to do is use the desired capabilities. So I'm going to have a Chrome for this. For the example I'm going to have is we're going to use Chrome. And all I need to do is add a capability for proxy and pass in the proxy object. Then I just go create my web driver. So it's actually really simple. And if you've got sort of code for doing common management for creating your drivers, it's really, really easy to actually add this to your tests. So I'm actually going to now do a live demo. So fingers crossed. Okay, so this is that. There's not a lot going on in there. What I've done is I've written a web driver test for my favorite CI system, Jenkins, and it's going to create a CI job in there. All the test traffic's going to go through Zap, and I'll show you what the results are. So I'm just going to start this up. So the reason I've chosen Jenkins is I'm going to fill in a couple of forms. So it actually gives Zap some good information about what it can do with Jenkins. So my test's passed. If I was to go to Jenkins, you can actually see my test has actually created a job. So it's actually worked correctly. If I go back to Zap, I can see I've got a little yellow flag, orange flag there. And that's indicating that Zap has found something in the HTTP traffic. I have a set of tabs across the bottom. So we could look at the history to see what traffic Zap's been looking at. But also we've got an alerts tab, which can actually highlight all the different issues found from this test run. So Zap suspects it's found a cross-site request forgery problem with Jenkins. By the way, this Jenkins system I've actually set up to be insecure. I've deliberately made it insecure, so these aren't real issues. This particular request is actually a false positive, and I'd have to filter this out as a manual tester analyzing the results. But some of the other issues, like the cookies, so the issues about cookies not being limited to HTTP only, this is a valid issue. So I can open up each issue found by Zap. It can also, it will provide me the name of the issue, the risks to the application, the reliability of the scanning analysis. So it's just providing a warning, which means that it's like this vulnerability is likely to be there. It also has several different reliability levels for its analysis. So suspicious, it's something you still want to look into. But I could manually set this as false positive. Also has the parameters that were used within the attack. So if I wanted to recreate the attack, I could actually collect the information from the field and actually run it, the HTTP traffic again to replicate the issue. We've also got documentation on the issue. And we've got, so you'll have, you can have suggested further reading to find solutions. So at the bottom, we've got a link to an OWASP page, which can provide more information on this. So at the moment, it's found very minor issues. Okay. That was just a passive analysis of the traffic. What we can now do, now Zap understands different functions within Jenkins, we can actually now attack them. So that's an active scan. You just select the site you want to attack, which is localhost. And I just hit the play button. Okay. This will probably take about 8 minutes, so it's going to be a rather boring presentation if I leave this. You can actually see at the bottom here all the different HTTP requests going through, all the different attack attempts. So I'm just going to actually stop this and load up some data I created earlier. So I'm just loading data that I did an attack earlier today. It shouldn't take too long. But what we'll find is that Jenkins actually has some vulnerabilities I've configured into it, in particular a cross-site scripting attack. For those of you not familiar with that, that's essentially embedding JavaScript into a web page. So if you're filling in a form and you put JavaScript into a field, it can be rendered on a web page and that JavaScript could be malicious and actually be used to, say, hijack your session. So if I go back to alerts, you can see I've got a whole range of additional issues. So I've got the cross-site scripting. I've got all the different URLs that it occurs on. There's quite a few. And I could double-click on them to find further information on them. You can even see at the top the actual JavaScript that was injected to the page. Just to prove that the vulnerability exists, I'm going to open up Jenkins. And I'm going to edit the job and actually paste some JavaScript in. So I've saved that information. And you can now see I've actually a JavaScript dialog coming up. So I injected JavaScript into the page that's being rendered. So this is a really, really common attack, and it's probably the most common to be found, but it can be quite simple to protect against. Okay, so this is still a manual process, but we're just leveraging our automated tests to actually populate the data. We actually have gone through several phases of this. First stage, about 8 months ago, we were just doing this manually. And we've actually now gone through the steps of automating this. So we've integrated this into our continuous build process. Zap can actually be completely controlled remotely through a RESTful API. So it doesn't actually matter what build technology you've got, as long as you can make HTTP requests, you should be able to control Zap. The Zap project has created a set of ANT tasks for doing this from your build. I've been working on a Maven plugin. I haven't quite got it out and published yet, but it should be available shortly in a few weeks' time. And the common tasks that you need to be able to do to automate the security analysis with Zap is session management. So this is clearing out old data, saving data that you've recorded through your test run and opening up data. You want to be able to run the active attack and the spider. And you want to be able to filter rules out. So if you have false positives and you know they're going to occur, you can actually write rules to ignore these false positives. Okay. From those simple attacks, we actually saw there's quite a lot of data. And actually, only about a third of them were actually real vulnerabilities that I configured. The rest were false positives. So the human security analysis job is very much safe for the moment. But a lot of those issues could be picked up every time the build's run. So we did find significant value from actually implementing this as a CI process. The major downside of managing the false positives at the moment is when, with the ANT task, you've actually got to put all these rule exceptions into your ANT build file. And this is actually a bit of a pain because the build file should be just for build information. This is test and compliance information, and it should be stored separately. And it's the key reason I actually haven't finished the Maven plugin, because I actually want to solve this problem. So the normal workflow for doing Zap in the CI is we start Zap. You need Zap installed on the machine, but the Ant task can actually start it for you, so it could be fresh. Normally, we'd do the manual testing, but we can replace this with running our browser tests. Once all our browser tests are run for a single particular user role, we can then do our active scan, check the results, save the session if you want later human analysis, and we stop Zap. So quite simple. I'm not going to go into the individual Ant tasks. I am going to be providing some links to an example build file. If we get time, we could have a look at it, but we probably won't. So our first step of integrating this into CI was rather simple. We did a nightly build, because you can see that I only run one test on Jenkins, and actually the attack can actually take 8 minutes for that single test. So if you've got a test suite that takes 4 hours to run, your security analysis is probably going to take 8 hours to run. So it's something we started off running at night for the whole application. And what we did was actually run the attacks, do the passive and active, and actually save this session and actually email the results to the testers at the end of the day. And the test, in the morning. And the testers would open up and actually look at the data and actually do human analysis, which was really good, because we got highly accurate results. We weren't failing our build because of false positives, because we still had the human in the loop. Problem is, I really like continuous builds. I like to run my tests constantly. So, and I like this because of fast feedback. And I really wasn't getting this. So I thought we had more value to get from actually failing our builds if security vulnerabilities had been introduced. So stage two is we did the same nightly build with the active attack, emailing it to our testers, who would then look at the results. But we added the passive scanning to our build, to our continuous build. So every time a check-in took place, we'd look at for the common HTTP header problems. This meant if somebody incorrectly configured a cookie, we'd pick this up and fail it straight away. And we actually got quite a bit of benefit out of that. But we still had the problem that we weren't picking up all the issues. And in particular, we weren't picking up the cross-site scripting issues and the SQL injection attacks. So we actually went on to the next stage. So we actually put it fully into our continuous build, both active and passive scanning. This really did have a problem, because we got lots of false positives. And it became quite common for the developers to actually start putting in rule exceptions into the Ant build file. We ended up with about 500 rule exceptions into the build. It was a complete mess. And the only way I could sort it out was enforcing a code review for every time an exception went in. And it really sort of lost us some confidence in the process. So this is an area I'm still working on. I'm not working on it full-time because I'm no longer working on this e-commerce system. So it's very much a hobby project to actually keep this technique going forwards until I find another suitable project to put it to use on. So if anybody tries to re-implement this, I would actually be wary of this problem. And this is probably one of the biggest lessons I had. Okay, so we actually got huge return on investment, quite a large return on investment from reusing our tests. So we've spent all our time maintaining our tests, but we actually saved an estimated 20% of our security budget by actually implementing this technique. The security professional we brought in, he could actually focus on particular areas of applications, particular vulnerabilities that Zap couldn't pick up. So we really had great savings there. This works really well for catching cross-site scripting attacks, SQL injection, minor HTTP problems. That was pretty good, but there's about seven or six different security issues in the OS top 10 that we didn't actually pick up. So there's still way to, there's still some way to go forwards. This is new. I'm not a security professional, so I'm sure there's elements that I could learn to actually improve this ratio. But I was pretty pleased with the results, and the team was as well. So the downside for this has been the level of false positives. We still need a lot of human interaction to filter out these rules. But any analysis technique that's automated that I've used, you always end up with rule exceptions somewhere. So this is the area I'm going to focus on. We've actually got a bit of time, so I can actually show you how we integrated this into Ant. It's really, really messy because I wasn't actually intending to show this. So this is actually an example which I've got a link for on my last slide. These are all the different rule exceptions here. So you can see there's quite a lot. And they all have to be within our alert check. So this is where we fail our build if we have alerts. So we need to put the rule exceptions in here. The tasks are really simple for running the job, so we can actually get Zap to go to a particular URL. We can actually get it to run the spider. So if you don't have a full test suite, so we didn't actually have a, we had about 50% coverage from our web drivers tests for application, so we had a few holes, so we did actually run the spider. To actually fill in any of these holes of the application we hadn't tested. This was good because obviously we've had holes. The downside, I'd say, is that if you've got a form that has JavaScript that adds and takes away form elements, if you don't actually completely exercise that within your test in a browser, Zap is not going to know about every single field in your post in your post requests. So that is a downside. And you can make this work with low test coverage, high test coverage, you'd get better results. There's always a good argument about how much test coverage you should have, so I'll leave that one to everybody to debate. So we use, you can use the spider, whoops, you can use the, so you have, we've spidered our application, then we can actually just one command again to perform our active attack, and then it's another Ant task to actually save our data, and then you could just use your CI infrastructure, like we use Jenkins, and we've set up Jenkins to actually email this out to the testers at the end of the day. Also, you can, to fail the build, you just have to add the rule exceptions. And check task. So it's just one call, you have your rule exceptions in there, and it can fail the build for you. So it's quite simple to actually get running. There's a few areas we're going to look to expand, like next time I use it on a project, I'd look to see if we could use the grid to help manage Zap instances, because obviously you can only be running one type of tests through Zap at a time. So having multiple Zap instances and using, say, grid and capabilities to actually direct the HTTP traffic to the correct attack proxy would be quite good. So, just go back. So, that's it. The links for the demo code for the Jenkins test run I did is on GitHub. Zap can be found on Google Code. OWASP, if you want to look up more information about security and learn a bit more. And the Ant build file, a demo, is in Subversion. So, anybody got any questions?
Yes. Yeah, so thank you, Alan. Okay. And we do have a couple minutes for Q&A.
I've got one question. Is this thing on? Hello. Regarding this false positive problem you were talking about, is there any way you can configure SAP, for example, just to focus on a specific subset of issues, like maybe these top 10 security issues you were talking about, and then you leave maybe the false positive checks for the manual verification.
Okay, so you can actually configure in Zap, sort of, you've got very coarse-grained control over what rules are run. So you can say the rule, particular rules are run for the whole application or not at all. The ant task, that's where we actually had to filter out individual rules based on a path. So that's probably something I didn't show very well. So we actually have to specify what the we have to specify the URL of what we want to ignore. And we can use wildcards and expression matching on that to do that. So you can do coarse-grained control, but you can't set that from ant at the moment, which is something that actually I do want to do. So when I get round to it, I will add that, or somebody else on the project will add that. But for the moment, we actually have to filter out the results and start ignoring them when we want to fail the build. So it is limited in that respect.
I think it was quite interesting to get the security testing integrated within the CI, but like you mentioned, the problem is of the false positives. I was wondering, your assertions were included within the ZAP and the build file, which was then failing it because of the false positives. I was wondering, did you try and explore if the part where you're just dumping the result file and just add, just have Java JUnit test to just analyze and check for assertions, okay, if this is there, then fail the build, rather than let Zap have it, just have a Java file or another JUnit test as a build step or a second build or a dependent build to do that and then fail the build accordingly. That way you'll be just adding tests which you want them to fail rather than the false ones.
That's That is interesting. We actually did do some unit tests because Zap does give you the URL that the exception caused on. So it is actually quite easy to copy and paste this into a JUnit test and actually run that.
Just search within that file of this rule is there, because you know it would be just like reading another file and just failing the test.
The problem is we had high frequency check-ins, and you can have an exception in, and then at some point you need to remove the exception. These rules exceptions were a real problem, so it is an issue. But good idea of doing the JUnit test, because I think that's one direction to go. And this is very sort of new, certainly new to me. I don't know anybody else doing anything like this. I know people are using passive proxies.
I was actually experimenting on using not Zap, but I think Fiddler has a plugin for Cassava security. Evil Tester's blog explains it in a lot of detail. And what it was doing was dumping, you can have it dump the file, then you can have your tests. So the automated tests run while Fiddler running with security being enabled. Another test step could just go and analyze that file and report failures based on that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, everybody. One more round of applause. Keeping this right on track. Next talk is going to be right in about 5 minutes. So come on up, Jeff Rogers and Dima Kovalenko, if I pronounced that right. I think I got that right. Let's call him Dima. From Groupon. Also, a plug for the Group B track. One of the conference organizers, Ashley Wilson, and my coworker at Sauce Labs, she'll be in track B talking about building a Selenium community one meetup at a time. And here's a trick. If you want the Selenium conference to be in your city, and it's not London or San Francisco at this point, a really great precursor to having the Selenium conference in your city is to have a great meetup community in that city. So if you don't have a Selenium meetup in your city, go to Ashley's talk to find out how to do that. And we're going to have a couple minutes here while Jeff and Dima set up. Thank you.